and seeing what's going on Facebook, what's going on Instagram. It's your boy Big Ant, aka Mr. Diamond Status, and I am filling in for the one and only Rachel J. So y'all make sure y'all send some hearts and some love to her. She's under the weather right now. Rachel, we love you. Can't wait to see you soon. Get well, take care of yourself. So I'm the special guest host for On The Scene. Shout out to Marbra for inviting me. And man, we about to just go ahead and get started. The men are taking over On The Scene, all right? So on tonight, we have a special guest we have with me. And you know what I'm saying? Just coming to chop it up with us. I read your bio, you know, and like I said, you know, before we came live, it's straight to the point. So that's kind of pretty much what we're going to do, man. We're going to get straight to the point and just, man, let the people know, first of all, who are you?
Well, first of all, I want to thank On The Scene for having me. I appreciate the love. Well, I'm Dion Greer. That's me. Entrepreneur, I want to say young. I'm not that young, but I'm still young. I grew up in Robert Taylor Projects, 4101 South Federal. Stayed there till I was about 15.
Wow, okay.
That's where my struggle started, pretty much. I seen a lot of things being young. My mom, she was 13 going on 14 when she had me.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, my grandmother kind of stepped in and, and took over. I knew who my mom was. I was around. I knew she was my mom. Yeah, we kind of grew up a little bit together, her being so young. So, you know, my father was around. My father, you know, he ended up going to the Army.
Okay.
Moved us out to California when I was younger. So it was like kind of back and forth. It was only for a year or so that we stayed out there. And but most of the time it was 41st and Federal. That's born and bred, low end, Robert Taylor.
So, man, let's shout out to the Robert Taylor homes, man. So, with you growing up in the Robert Taylor homes, man, kind of elaborate, because, you know, there's a whole generation that really don't understand or don't know what the projects are. Or they don't even understand the mentality that you have to have growing up in the projects. So kind of break it down, take us back in time to what it was like, you know, growing up, you know, the Robert Taylor homes on the low end.
Well, it was kind of different for me. The reason I say it was different because I have a big family.
Okay.
My grandmother, she had 15 kids.
Whoa.
And her sister had 19. So, and we wasn't all in the same project, but we was always together. And my grandmother's kids were in Robert Taylor, and her sister's kids was pretty much spread it out to Stay Way and the Ickies and Ida B. Wells. And, you know, so in the 80s, it was rough. It was rough. In some ways it was, in some ways it wasn't. I mean, back when I was young, because everyone was from the same building and we knew everyone, you were able as a kid to go downstairs and play in a park or on the slab boards or the monkey bars and play basketball without really have to worry about shooting and things like that. It was until I got a little bit older and we kind of didn't have a choice. My building was opposite gang than all the other buildings going down State Street. So it was something.
Okay.
It definitely was something. But man, it pretty much made me the person I am today. I mean, my friends, the guys that I looked up to, who I wanted to run downstairs and play football with, play basketball with, they end up, not all of them, but a couple of them end up going to jail around. They were about from the ages of 15 to maybe 19.
Okay.
They all went to jail, spent, I think, maybe about 20 years. And for a kid, when your friends leave, mm-hmm. and then it's kind of everybody else, well, I still have friends there, but the guys who showed us how to play basketball, mm-hmm. showed us how to play football and baseball, they were gone. Mm-hmm. So we had to find something else, you know, to turn our minds to. And at that time, it was some changes taking place in Robert Taylor. I don't really want to get too much into it, but mm-hmm. it was some changes taking place. And in my eighth grade year, my best friend got killed on the 16th floor in our project. And I guess after that, my mom was like, it's time to go.
Right.
It's time to go. And my grandmother had moved to Auburn Gresham.
Okay.
Maybe 2 years prior mm-hmm. to me being in eighth grade. And so when that happened, my mom was ready for me to go. So I ended up moving to Auburn Gresham.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thinking that you move out of the projects into a middle class neighborhood, that everything going to be okay.
Right.
Still end up moving to the hood. Still end up moving to the hood.
So tell us about Auburn Gresham. Like, you know, I'm familiar with the area. Like, where about in Auburn Gresham?
Well, we stayed on 87 in between Troop and Elizabeth.
Yeah.
So, and that was rough too.
Yeah.
I mean, my grandmother moved in 86. Mm-hmm. 86, 87 out there. I didn't get that till about 90, 91.
Mm-hmm.
Auburn Gresham had made the turn, and no Gaines was out, you know, full force. But at that time, if I'm not mistaken, at that time, a kid got shot in Caprini Green.
Mm-hmm.
It was a young boy, and they called a citywide peace treaty. At that time, it was, I want to say, late 80s, early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of settled things down for a minute, because you have gang here, gang here, and then you got a different gang that sits in the middle. So it wasn't easy.
Right.
Definitely wasn't easy, but my friends, you know, today, the guys that I call my friends and my buddies from 87, mm-hmm. you know, it was all love, you know. Yeah. It's just like now you got cliques mm-hmm. instead of gangs. It's people that you know that'll look out for you is the ones you look out for them.
Right.
So
right.
It ended up, like I say, it was still tough, you know. It wasn't easy at all. It wasn't spoon, you know, we didn't have a silver spoon. It was really tough, but you know, I had, by the time I moved to Auburn Gresham, I had fell in love with basketball also. So, you know, that took me away from the city.
Okay, yeah. So, you know, I mean, just hearing your story from, you know, growing up in projects to move into what some would consider a better lifestyle. But the thing is, from, you know, hearing what you're saying is that a lot of times people have this misconception that you can, it's like they look down on the projects and they look at a different area, but not realizing that no matter where you go, if you still have the struggles of poverty or gang activity, that stuff can actually, you know, follow you, you know, everywhere you go. And so one of the key things you said was that basketball kept you away from a lot of that stuff. So, how can you tell people today to stay away from the violence or stay away from gang activities? Because some people are not, you know, into sports or not good. So what else is it that, you know, they can do, you know, to kind of stay away from that stuff?
Man, there's a lot of things to do, you know, programs, and things such of that nature, but it's kind of different for me. I was kind of a different kid. I mean, I have siblings, and like I said, I had a big family. Right. But me as a kid, I used to never really share this story with nobody, but true story.
Okay.
Back in the day, projects and when I moved, I was able to sit down by myself. And I used to get pennies and nickels because I love sports. I used to get pennies and nickels and quarters. And I used to line them up like football. Mm-hmm. I'd get the defensive line, offensive line, receivers back. And I played football with change.
Really?
Or I grab a hanger, make a basketball rim, stick it on the door, grab a sock, and I play basketball by myself. So I never really, it was never I had to go out and play with everybody else. Because I learned how to do it within myself.
Okay.
So to answer your question, for a kid that's trying to get out the life or trying not to get to the life, you have to find yourself. You have to be able to be comfortable with yourself. Because most of the time when you join something, not all the time, but most of the time when you join something, it's because you're lacking of something. So if you learn how to be one with yourself, and you can sit in the room by yourself, other things you probably wouldn't pull to. And I think if a kid learn how to open their mind, expand their mind by itself, then they probably won't go to the army.
Right. I mean, I feel you on that. And then, you know, one of the things growing up in the 80s, early 90s, versus today is one of the main things that has changed is the level of technology. And the funny thing is, here you say, man, I had an opportunity to sit by myself. Now, I'm trying to imagine, you know, a child in 2018 going and just really just sitting by themselves without a cell phone, without an iPhone, without an iPad, without a computer. And it's like, you know, we had the opportunity to breed creativity because we didn't have a lot of distractions. And so now we have all this technology. So taking the time, if you go back to your younger self and put him in 2018, what are some of the creative things that you think that you will be able to do now?
That's a good question, because even though we didn't have cell phones, computers was just coming out, but you had to be filthy. You know, they didn't have a computer, so that wasn't it. But we did have Ataris. I had an Atari. We had ColecoVision.
Yeah.
A game. I had that. So I had games to play. It was just, I don't know, it was just something about sports, you know. It wasn't many sports games when it first came out with the games. Right. It wasn't many sports games, but I always loved sports. So, you know, that made me want to continue to, you know, just be by myself. And two, because I always had a big family and I was always around someone. I was always around noise. Sometimes it was just good to just, you know, get away, you know, and be by yourself and think good thoughts. You know, because when you're around a lot of people, you can't control what other people do. You know, and energy is something. It is something. If it's bad, if bad energy can stick to you, you know. So I'm trying, I just try to move away from bad energy. If it's not productive, if it's not gonna help me and my kids eat, if it's not gonna make me smile, then pretty much I don't wanna be around. And it's not being selfish, because I mean, if someone else is smiling and they're having a good time, then that wears on me.
Right.
So as long as it's good energy, then you know, I'm with it. You know, I'm with it.
Cool. So let's put on that good energy, man. Let's tell me what was one of your favorite moments growing up in the Robert Taylor Homes?
As much was going on, I had a lot of great memories.
Okay.
My childhood. One, I remember we had a basketball court in the middle of our buildings. We had 4101, 4037, and 4022. And then we had our grammar school, Edward Hardigan, that kind of made the square.
Mm-hmm.
So in the middle, we had basketball courts. And I remember watching Marcus Liberty, Daryl Liberty, you know, all down. And these guys that I knew, you know, family members, was out there playing ball, and it was different gangs and enemies out there all playing and enjoying each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was a great memory. And although this might seem a little strange, but I remember one day, true story, the kids in our building, they used to have a football camp. It was called the Apaches.
Okay.
And they took the kids in the projects, and I don't know where they went to go play football and learn football, but I missed the bus. It was a couple of us that missed the bus, excuse me. So what we did was, it was 8 o'clock in the morning, we started walking. Like, we gonna find out where they at. So we walked and we walked and we walked, and it seemed like a long, long time. And we ended up at Washington Park. End up in Washington Park after a long walk. I mean, it seemed like we walked forever. But of course, now that I'm older, I know it wasn't that far. And when I walked, it was me and a couple of friends, and we sat in the grass, we talked. It was a get away from the project type thing. So it was all the frustrations that you had, you were able to get away from it. And so we laid in the grass, and we heard some noise. We heard people coming in, and when we finally got up and went over to the people that was talking, it was a baseball team. And went over there, and the guys, they was kind of talking, you know, talking a little crazy to us because they didn't know us. And I say maybe 5 minutes later, my auntie and my uncle showed up. They were actually coaching the baseball team.
Wow.
Now, I hadn't seen my uncle and my auntie in maybe about 2-3 years,
okay.
3-4 years. And I ended up stopping playing baseball after that. You know?
Word.
So that was a great memory.
Man, that's dope, man. That's dope. So, you know, just to get a little bit, let the people know why I was asking that question, is because a lot of times when we grow up in certain environments, we become a product of that environment. And we carry that energy from generation to generation to generation. And so, and you know, we see it. We see, you know, grandmama was in the hood, and so she raised her children like that. Then the children, you know, and it's a trickling effect. And so, and you have, you, if you ask people, man, tell us, what are some of the good stuff that happened? They can't really tell. Because they're so busy focusing, like you said, the energy focusing on the bad stuff and the stuff that who got shot and all that other stuff that they never had an opportunity to appreciate their childhood or appreciate, you know, because even in the struggle, there's always some type of silver lining that says, boom, you know, well, I remember being this age and I understand that I found my purpose, or I found my hustle, I found my grind. And so the reason I wanted to, I was asking the question about background stuff is so now that we can talk about the present. Because without a past, you don't have a present. Correct. And so now, let's talk about the man you are today. Now, you are an entrepreneur, you're a businessman, and you're a father. Now, you know, we want to dabble a little bit into you know, each one. So first, tell us, man, you know, what does the G stand for?
Okay, I'm glad you asked. We'll get to that. Well, we started off talking about my childhood, Robert Taylor, which is the struggle. I made the G on the concept of this statement. If you ever been through a struggle in life and you're still standing out, the sun is shining on you. So the bricks in the drawing is the struggle. Those are the bricks of the Robert Taylor projects that I came up with. Okay. And the still standing part, no matter how long something is on this earth, it changes. Some go up and then they come down. One thing I noticed growing up from here to here, the only thing that ever stood the same are the pyramids in Egypt. No matter what. They've been through range. I don't know if it's snow, but you know, a lot of different things, you know, but it's still standing. Yeah. So that's why I came up with the still standing. Now the sun is shining up on you. And of course, my last name is Greer.
Okay.
So it's pretty much you. You know, this represents you. Everyone that comes on this earth been through a struggle. Rather it's you lost your job, you lost your wife, something happened with your kids, you got to pay a bill. It's always something that's a struggle. And as long as you stay positive through that struggle and keep going and keep pushing, the sun will shine on you. You'll get an opportunity to be great. So that's
okay. Man, that is... I mean, that's what's up, man, because you know what, especially in fashion, we have a lot of, we rock a lot of stuff, and we spend thousands of dollars on stuff that doesn't have a meaning. And so, and it's like, I'm not knocking no other brand, nothing like that, but I believe that now is the opportunity, it's a time for entrepreneurs, fashion designers, to come out with a brand that represents something. And, you know, just like you rocking, you know, you have your shirt and the G, you know, we stand and all that other stuff. I feel the same way about my brand. You know, Diamond Status is, it's what it is it's for so long we have been part of the status quo. You know, we say black men, we don't expect to live past 20. You know, if you're black, you're going to be incarcerated. And, you know, like you said, the struggle is always, we always are succumbed to the powers of our struggle, but not overcoming it. And so, and with Diamond Status, I believe, and I know for a fact, that every diamond has to go through some type of pressure. And so, and I just, you know, we came to the realization and said, you know what, we're not gonna be the status quo, but we're gonna be the king of the status. We're gonna be the ones that set the standard. And that's where we came up with the name Diamond Status. Is that no matter what, you always go shine bright.
Right.
No matter the pressure, you go come out strong because the diamond is the toughest material on the earth. Period. No other jewel can cut, other material can cut a diamond but another diamond. And so when you was talking about, you know, when you was talking about your brand, it brought a lot of clarity. And it's, you know, and it, a part of me, you know, woke up and said, man, it really make you sit back and think like, hey, man, that show didn't take me out.
Right.
You know, and for so long, we put honor and we put praise on the struggle, but we don't celebrate the victory, you know, after the struggle. And so, and when you're talking about the sun, man, it's like no matter what, you can have a the darkest storm. But if you hold out in the storm, the sun has no choice but to sign. That's its assignment.
Yep.
And so, you know, and I think it's time for, especially our brothers, man, our black men, to really step up and start encouraging other brothers and encouraging our culture. Because, and I want to get your input on where the culture is going today, is that I think our culture is at a place to where it's still trying to figure out who we are, but we're also in a place that we have a color around us that is causing entertainment, fashion, all this other stuff to lead us and tell us who we are. So you being in fashion, are you satisfied with the way fashion is going, especially in our black media?
With fashion is fashion is sort of kind of like music and art,
mm-hmm.
to me.
Mm-hmm.
Just my opinion. It's like one of the things that made me really want to bring out a clothing line is, mm-hmm. I worked with fashion for maybe about 4 or 5 years.
Okay.
I worked with a media company called Red Carpet Concierge International, and shout out Hayes Sandy, beautiful lady, very, very nice, wonderful. One thing I noticed working with her, being mm-hmm. around her, it's just like when I was younger.
Mm-hmm.
You had some kids that couldn't afford the Michael Jordans.
Right.
And you had certain kids that could.
Mm-hmm.
And those that could talked about those who couldn't.
Right.
And it's like, right now, today, we still at that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you don't wear what majority mm-hmm. likes, not wearing it because majority not wearing it, mm-hmm. but what the majority likes, then you're different.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason why I came out with the line, to kind of bridge the gap between, let's say, couture and urban.
Mm-hmm.
I want to bring them together because it's still like separated. A lot of times I get turned down for fashion shows because I'm not more of the couture designer.
Okay.
You know, I heard you reference the brand, you know, the words in the We Trust. You know, that was just something I actually put on the shirt. I actually only own this logo.
Mm-hmm.
It's my trademark, and it's like a bridge.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bridge, because even if you're a couture designer wearing the long gown, you got the long gowns, the mm-hmm. $1 million dresses,
right.
or you urban with the $40 shirts,
yeah.
it's all the same. When you put it on, it's how you feel,
right.
what you believe,
right.
what you think. The skinny jeans,
mm-hmm.
The tight shirts, the wearing your pants down, and I don't like it, to be honest. And a lot of kids nowadays, like I'm not in the streets, but I'm still a part of the streets because
mm-hmm.
I grew up in the streets. And you know, I try to, if you knew anyone that I know in the streets, that's kids I know, actually kids that's out here in it,
mm-hmm.
they'll tell you that I don't waver. If I see you with your pants down, I'm gonna talk about you.
Right.
I'm gonna ask you, man, put your pants up.
Right,
you know?
Right.
If you go into an interview, I'm the one to tell you, man, put on a tie.
Yeah.
You know? Or put on a collar shirt or something.
Right.
You can still be cool
mm-hmm.
and be casual.
Right. Right.
You don't always have to, you know, have your pants sagging
mm-hmm.
and your shirts tight, or white beat on,
right.
showing your underwear, you
yeah,
don't have
yeah,
to do
yeah.
that to be cool. You can still be cool and not be that way. And I brought this brand to bring pants and shirts and hoodies and sweaters and, and dress apparel, so the kids nowadays can make that crossover and still be in the norm from where you are. If you're in the streets, you still can be normal, but you understand what I'm saying? But that's a hard question. I don't want to down anyone. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to try to keep positive energy out. It's kind of hard when you got, you know, kids nowadays. I mean, not just kids, but people. You have grown-ups that, you know, still their mind is just, you know, they want to be with the majority. Mm-hmm. A lot of people like it. It was always like a lot of people like to be with the majority. Mm-hmm. And I was just different.
The individual. And you know, the reason why I asked that question is because a lot of times, like you said, we go with the majority. We are a culture that goes with the flow. And so, and it's like, I've actually been out shopping and I've had heard guys say, man, you know, I ain't really with the skinny jeans, though, man, but because, you know what I'm saying, females like it. I'm a rock it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So now because you mentioned bridging that gap, there is, you know, a group of men and women that's looking at the culture, that's looking at today's fashion. It's like, okay, yeah, that's what everybody else is doing, but I really prefer to have this.
Right.
And two things that, you know, you said, but you really, you know, you didn't say, but, you know, I got the gist of what you're saying. It's, you know, it's okay if that's what you want to do. That's fine. That's your taste. Cool. But it's also even better if you want to be an individual. And so, and that's something, you know, that I want to encourage the listeners and those that are watching, that it's okay to be an individual. You know, it's okay to, man, you know, just because you got 50 people crossing this street right here, it's okay that you say, you know what, I'm going to take this way. You know, every trailblazer has their own trail, you know what I'm saying, to blaze.
Yeah, blaze, yeah.
And so, and that's something that that I see that you're doing, is that you're taking that, you know, you're taking that medium and you said, well, I'm going to just bridge it together.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna give them a choice.
Right.
Of, hey, if you don't like that, you have this option.
Right.
So now you do also do brand. So kind of give me an understanding of, so those who don't know what branding is, kind of break down what branding really is.
I mean, branding is basically, you know, you have something, you basically, it's, it's a guy by the name of Emory Jones. Mm-hmm. He has a great quote with his clothing. I hope, you know, all rights is cool, mm-hmm. but I always see him say, better himself, mm-hmm. you know. And you as an individual are a brand. You know, you are... I mean, you're a brand. You are you.
Right.
No matter what you do, no matter which way you go, you are you. So, you got a brain freeze.
It's all good, man.
It's letting everyone know about you. Mm-hmm. Letting everybody know what you have going on, what you're trying to make happen. Right now, we are in the process of letting everyone know about the Jew, because right now I still have people a little afraid of, you know, because I have some people to say it's gang related.
Mm-hmm.
I have some people who says it's I'm with the Illuminati. they chant. But then you got some people saying, you know, I'm a Mason, and I'm not. You know, Brandon is about, you know, making something happen with yourself and carrying yourself in a certain type of way. And I'm working very, very hard to make sure that everyone know when you see the Jeep, because it's not gonna just stop with clothing.
Right.
I promoted parties. I consulted for artists and other clothing brands. Because I do have the trademark and I do own the trademark, I plan on it being in everybody's household, on everything, you know? So when you see it, you know it's, you will feel that, man, that struggle I went through, I'm gonna be okay.
Yeah.
You know, no matter if you're looking at your TV and you see the G on your TV, you're gonna be like, man, I've been through that struggle, but I'm gonna be okay. You know, if you see it on your microwave, because we plan on making microwaves too.
That's what's
You, it's just, I want everyone to have that feeling when they see that G, that, man, I went through something just like he did. I made it out just like he did. Yeah. I can do something great just like he did. So,
you know, that's kind of the power. I want to talk about, I don't know, the power of the G.
Mm-hmm.
Man, reading your bio, man, I see that you've been doing some great things with disabled youth.
Yeah.
Kind of elaborate on that, man. Tell us what you've been doing with that.
Okay, well, for amount of time I worked for the Chicago Public Schools, substituted with disabled kids. I worked at different schools, different high schools, different grammar schools. 2008, I ended up getting a permanent spot in Gwendolyn Brooks. I basically sat in the classroom, helped kids write, read, learn, help them go around, get to their classes. Basically, you know, just being the teacher for them.
Mm-hmm.
So the teacher wouldn't have to basically put all their all into that one student, that student, or those couple of students had me and the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I learned a lot from that. Patience. I was a young man with no patience, but after that, you know, you see something so special, and that pretty much can't do everything that a normal kid can do, and it kind of hits you.
Yeah.
You know, you kind of feel sorry, but you know, you see them trying so hard. To get it right, and over and over and over and over until they get it right, and it definitely helped me, you know, with the brand too, because just like I was talking about my struggle, they have a struggle every day, you know, they parents have a struggle every day taking care of them, and you know, just, I mean, they just keep you smiling. You know, even though you know it's hard for them, you know, it's to be able to help them out and see that you're doing something great for someone else, you know, it is wonderful. So I enjoyed my time at CPS. It was just that punching that clock. working for other people, I couldn't do it anymore. I mean, it's nothing. I'm not knocking anyone with a regular 9-to-5.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you got to feed your family. You got to do what you got to do.
Right.
That's fine. I understand that. But it's hard. And what I learned, because while I was working for the board, I started promoting parties, and it was kind of hard to concentrate solely on one thing, and you're working 8 hours. So I got to get up at 5 in the morning. But if you're at the school at 8, I get out of the school about 4. So I stay all the way up north. You go, you don't get home till about 7 or 8. Then you eat, play with your kids for an hour, and then you go to sleep, and then you're back at the game. that was a little bit too much for me. I couldn't keep continue to do that. So if I was gonna work hard for someone, I was gonna work hard for myself to make it happen. And that's why I've been since 2008, I've been on this path to, you know, make the G last forever.
I mean, that's dope, man. That's what's up. That's man, that's real. So speaking about, you know, entrepreneurship, man, let's tackle that, because there are a lot of people, and I'm gonna be real, be honest, that is afraid of entrepreneurship. They may be called to it, they desire it, they know that's what they're going, but there's a part of them that's fearful. It could be because of they scared of failure. They're the first ones in their family to ever set out and do it. What can you say to encourage them and to give them, ignite their fire to, you know, for them to, man, just go on and do it. You know what I'm saying?
Well, when I first started, I had no loans. I had no investments. It was all me. People always told me, you need money. Mm-hmm. money. Mm-hmm. But me being patient, that's what I want to be patient. Nothing worth having is going to come quick. You have to be patient. You need a little money, mm-hmm. but you don't need the money you might think you need. Mm-hmm. I'll tell them to, you know, just be a beacon of light, and it'll come. If you stay positive and stay focused on what you want to do, mm-hmm. Everything that'll make that happen, it'll just come. Mm-hmm. You know, like I said, I had no money. I had no loans, and I had nobody to invest in me. So what I did, I set out on myself, I umpired high school sports. I am a official IHSA official. Oh, basketball, football, baseball, and girls fast pitch softball. And so I used that money and started my business. Everything I made, I put back in. It took a lot. Took a lot of sacrificing. But you just gotta stay focused on the goal. If you stay focused on the goal and you stay positive, everything will happen for you. Networking is the key. You definitely have to network. If you network, you can get a lot of things done without money. Mm. Without money. I know that for a fact. I've done it. Like I said, you just gotta be fearful. You know, you can't think about bad things. You know, you can't think about what could happen.
Yeah.
Bad. Think about the outcome of how great it's gonna be. And the story that you will be able to tell when you're done. And just remember, you know, it's a struggle, but you're still standing and the sun gonna shine on you.
That's dope, I had to go back to that, but that's what it is. But you know what? I'm glad you went back to that. It's because, you know, that goes back to, you know, the question I asked you about branding. Mm-hmm. See, whatever it is, I feel like this about branding is that, like you said, you are your brand. Mm-hmm. So you should be able to, whatever you believe about your product, you should be able to, boom, just say it without even guessing, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Without it sounding, you know, rehearsed or, you know, different things like that. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, being an entrepreneur, I heard you, one of the things, I mean, which you answered the follow-up question already. No, that's good though, that's good because, you know, you can always, when it comes to entrepreneurship, you can always go with the what ifs. Mm-hmm. And 9 times out of 10, we focus on, what if it don't work?
Right.
What if people don't support me? Mm-hmm. And so what you just did was, because I know a lot of people that might be watching, listening, might be asking that, well, What happens if I don't get this or if I don't get that? And what you did was you kind of, you know, you shattered that. And you made, and you said one of the number one thing when it comes to being an entrepreneur is don't focus on the bad. Be patient and focus on the good. And so, and that's I think that's something that's key when it comes to, you know, being an entrepreneur or in business school, anything. Let that be, you know, let that be a goal, let that be a focus that you have. You know, be patient, focus on the good. And, you know, and I say, you know, add to that, I say speak it. Whatever it is that you want to come from your business, your life, whatever, speak it. You know, because out of the mouth flows, you know, life or death. And whatever you speak and whatever you believe, it'll materialize and it'll manifest. Mm. And so, with that being said, man, I think, you have a great, you have a great product. Just sitting here talking to you, man, it kind of broke down a lot of paradigms that, you know, I had even myself about being, you know, entrepreneur. Because, man, I know for a fact, man, working for somebody, punch somebody else's clock, man. You know, you don't have, you become a slave to that system. Okay. You know, you become a slave. Yeah. You eat when they tell you to eat. Mm-hmm. You know, you come when they tell you to come. Mm-hmm. You leave when they, you know, they tell you to leave. You know, and you able to take off when they say you can take off. And so, you know, even though being an entrepreneur is hard work, mm-hmm. but the reward pays off.
Yes.
Now, rewards and payoff and entrepreneurship, man, let's give me three entrepreneurs that you admire.
It's so many. I mean, it's so many. I don't want to leave nobody out. You put me on the spot.
Just three that just come to your head. Just like, boom.
Three. Let's say, say Sean Combs.
Okay.
I mean, that's Puffy. We're gonna say Bill Gates.
Okay. Two.
Benny. It's an artist of mine. His name is King Benny.
Okay.
He cuts hair. So mm-hmm. I guess you could say that's his own, you know, he has his own business. But the reason I picked him is of course he's not on the level of the other two that I picked, mm-hmm. but his work wonderful. I mean, you know, I've been around a lot of people that start their own companies and start doing what they want to do, mm-hmm. but their passion was there, but it can waver.
Mm-hmm.
His don't. And I mean, he has a lot going on. I mean, on the struggle side, it's so much going on in his life.
Yeah.
But yet, and still, he's still focus on that one thing. And I mean, if it was somebody who I admire, it's that guy.
And you know what? And that's dope, man. That's real. Because, and I'm glad you went there. Because a lot of times, you know, we admire the big dogs.
Right.
And, you know, you know, we admire them, like, yeah, man, they did their thing. But we forget the guy that lives across the street.
Right.
That started right. his own yard company.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because right. he was the only one in the wintertime with one of them grave digger shovels. You know,
right.
hey,
right.
can I shovel your snow? Right. And, you know, he was out the only one with his rake. You know what I'm saying? And I'm glad you went there, because there's a lot of entrepreneurs that, and I don't even want to use hood entrepreneurs, man. I just want to, I'm going to say local entrepreneurs mm-hmm. that are out here every day, you know, on their grind and mm-hmm. dedicated and faithful and really doing their thing. And, you know, they don't get the recognition of, you know, their peers. Mm-hmm. You know, like for me, I grew up 101st in Sangamon. And it's funny you mentioned a guy named Benny, because, you know, one of my local entrepreneurs that I admire is Mr. Benny at Washington Heights Barbershop. Okay. And I kid you not, from the time I was like little, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying, like 3-4 years old, he's been cutting hair and owning that shop. Even I drive past there today, man, that brother got to be like 77, 80.
Still pushing
and cutting hair, because you know what? That's his passion. And that's what he loved. And all the kids in the neighborhood, you know, started off going to him. And he gave a lot of these young cats the opportunity to come and get out this, you know, street and sweep hair. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And clean up and run the heralds and get their lunch and, you know, and stuff like that. And so one of the key things about being an entrepreneur is being able to change your environment. And so I want to ask you, man, have you seen those that are connected to you, your environment, have you seen any change?
Yes, true story. One point in time, I don't want to really get to the dates, because there are some people out there can narrow it down and know what I'm talking about. When I first started the line, mm-hmm. Earlier in the interview, I had said that, you know, I continue, even though, you know, I'm not in the streets, I'm mm-hmm. still in the streets.
Right.
And it was this one guy, I was around a lot. He was really, 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 really in the streets. I mean, really in the streets. And I talked to him every day. And, you know, I let him know, you know, it's other ways to do things. You know, you gotta learn how to approach people. Mm-hmm. You gotta be, you know, respectful,
yeah.
you know, to yourself, you know.
Right.
And if you love something, you know, try not to put it in harm's way. Mm-hmm. That's how you show someone you love them, not just by, you know, maybe affection, mm-hmm. but protecting them.
Right.
And protecting them not just by somebody walking up on you, fighting for them, but not putting them in harm's way.
Right. Right.
This guy, true story, make a long story short, mm-hmm. He's still in the streets at this time. He was about, I remember him coming back to me like, Man, I had him in my sight. I swear I had him in my sight. Mm-hmm. And the only reason I'm coming to you right now, because it was a kid there, and you told me that I should never do that around kids.
Wow.
True story. And that day, I knew that this was for me, because mm-hmm. not only did I probably save somebody else's life,
right.
I saved that kid's life from doing what he was about to do. Because
mm-hmm.
if he would have did it, it could have been a younger baby or something that probably would have, you know, been hurt from it. Or he would have hurt somebody, and then his life would have been gone forever.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, now it's his problem. And now it's his mom's problem or something like that. You know, so, I definitely see people changing. Everybody is digging the brand. You got people from all races, all colors. All creeds, you know, so I definitely see a lot of change.
Hey, that's what's up, man. And you know what? That's something that a lot of people can't say that they seen hands on change. And I commend you, man. I really applaud you that you are still a beacon of light in the street. And that's what's needed, man. Especially 2018, man. Every time you cut on the news, you know, somebody got shot. You know, 15 people died over the weekend, and you know, 38 people got shot. And it's like, man, I don't even watch the news anymore. Right. You know what I'm saying? Because it's always in the morning is bad. At noon is bad. You know what I'm saying? At night is bad. And it's so, you know, and like talked about the energy. I don't want that, man, to weigh on me to where I'm scared to go outside. Mm-hmm. You know, and I want to commend you, man. And I want to say, man, keep doing you, man. Keep doing your thing. Keep, man, representing the G. You know what I'm saying? And you definitely, man, you got my support, man.
I appreciate it, bro.
Looking forward to doing some things, you know, with you, man, and networking with you, man. And so, man, listen, give the people all your social media information. Where can they get the shirt from, man, and all that other stuff?
Well, you can order G Clothing at officialgclothing.com. That's officialgclothing.com. You can find me on Facebook, Dion Greer. Mm-hmm. Find me on Instagram, at Greer Inc. or at the_G_clothing USA. Twitter, Greer Inc. That's basically it. Or you find me in the streets. You'll see me around. I'm everywhere. So I'm not hard to find.
After the show, let me know where I can go pick up my shirt.
I got you. Right, I got you. I do want to, if I got a little time, okay. I do want to say, you know, it's a couple of people I want to say I appreciate. First I want to say, you know, give honor to God, man, but, you know, that's making it happen. You know, definitely. My babies, my four babies, my three girls, and my son, that's definitely holding daddy down. You know, I love y'all and I appreciate y'all. And, you know, my partners in crime, Catrice Anderson, I don't know where we'll be without you. Trey Lynn Brown, partner, I see you. See you out there working hard. Mr. D.L. Banks, that's my buddy. You know, give me a lot, you know, good words, Miss Sandra Smith Dummy. You know, I always gonna have love for her forever. She started me up. My moms, you can't leave mommy out. My grandmother, she's dead right now, God rest her soul. But I know she's looking down on me, my dad, my siblings, the whole city of Chicago, you know, everybody, south, north, west, east, everybody, suburbs. Everybody for holding me down and, you know, accepting the G. Because it didn't have to be accepted, but the fact that it's being accepted, I appreciate it.
That's good, man. Man, I love it, man. You know, hey, listen. This is your fill-in host, Big Ant, a.k.a. Mr. Diamond Status, sitting in for Rachel J for On The Scene. Yo, shout out to Rachel J. Honey, we miss you. We love you. Get better. Get well soon. And my check should be in the mail, right? All right, cool. We got you. All right. So, hey, look, listen. Y'all make sure y'all cop the Diamond Status tees. You know what I'm saying? Hey, you can follow me at Anthony Evans on Facebook. You can also go to www.thatgymapp.com/shop. All right, and you can order. Matter of fact, I'm gonna do a special On The Scene sale. You get two shirts for $35. All right. You can also follow me on Instagram at Mr_Diamond Status. Look, however you want to get your shirt, hey, holler at me. Two for $35. We got you. Hoodies coming soon. Hats coming soon. All that. Get ready for Diamond Status. So once again, I'm Big Ant. And thank you, shout out, man. Thank you so much, Dion, man, for coming through, man, with the power of G. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to Wanda C. Marbra. Thank you so much for having me. It was fun. All that other stuff. Hey, yo, if you did not see Empire, episode 502, you can catch me walking past Cookie and Terrence Howard. That was me. Go watch it and look and tag Lee Daniels and say, hey, he can be Bunky's son. He can have a part, whatever it is, get at me. Shout out to 4-Star Cast and all that good stuff. Until next time, be on the lookout. Big Ant got something coming up real soon. So y'all be on the lookout. Until next time, much love. Praise, honor to God for everything. And we out.
Shout out Sandy Lynn. Shout out Town Win that competition, baby.
That's right.